for anyone who is subscribed. So last night, as you guys know, I had done some more research on Nazareth Speedway, and we found some pretty cool stuff out. I did say I was going to pick up where I left off in the morning, but I got sidetracked. I slept till 10 o'clock and then woke up and hung out with my mom and stepdad for a bit, and then took a shower and got ready for line dancing tonight. So we're going to start with the different side of Mario Andretti. So I'm going to set my phone down so my phone stays still. So the Mario Andretti I've come to know since I started covering the series a few years ago has largely been genial, generous, open to any topic, but as he peels out of the driveway in my rented Elantra, he's taking us to a place I'm not sure he's keen to visit, and I'm curious whether a more, I butchered that word, I know I did, of Andretti will emerge. I heard before our trip he doesn't enjoy talking about the track with the Speedway much since its final race in 2004. He tells me he's only been back once when an NBC crew shot the Drive Like Andretti there some months ago. And while we were still at his office, when I mentioned that Janie Dale family had recently proposed plans to build distribution warehouses at the site, he seemed only vaguely familiar with that idea. The same goes for a pension some locals started to try and preserve the site. He sympathizes with their cause, but seems to have little faith anything can be done in that regard. En route to the defunct Speedway, I receive a phone call from David. Though he doesn't seem to know exactly what Andretti and I... But Andretti isn't much for... dawdling? It is basically just the gate's not completely closed. So yeah, like I said, it's basically not a hole. It's just the gate's not fully completely shut. It's not barricaded off the way it should be. If they're trying to keep people out. Where we're supposed to meet the photographer who will chronicle our visit, we'll take a quick peek, he says, then head back over to gate one to meet the gatekeeper. As we drive, Andretti is in good spirits. He delights in sharing the history of his hometown with me, though still retaining its small-town charm. Nazareth has changed quite a bit since his family arrived in 1955. Rather than showing me what is, he's pointing out what used to be, as if we are looking at old photographs. The auto body shop used to be a Sunoco station. He tells me his uncle owned it, and that's where he and his twin brother, Aldo, used to work after school. And that building on the corner there, he points through my side of the windshield. That's where they took their photograph with the first car they ever built, in Hudson Hawk. They took that photo just before the Hawks' debut. A 1959 race, Alto famously won after winning the coin toss to see which of the two brothers would drive the car first. "Where did you build that car?" I ask. "Everywhere," and Jody laughs. "We were like gypsies, going wherever we could to get that thing built." "Will it be this easy, I wonder," when I ask him about the speedway later on. "See that shopping center there?" Andretti says, pointing a typical dirt track. "That's where it all started." "That's not where we're going, though. The 1 1/8 mile track, built in 1966, refurbished and paved by then owner Roger Penske in 1987, sold to the International Speedway Corporation in 2004, doesn't realize we're standing in the pit area. Not on the track. It's not his fault. The jungle of cover the actual track is about. We make our way to the front stretch." I would assume that's what they meant. Jagged disrepair. Strewn with leaves and rocks, garbage, litters, and faculty, along with small pieces of metal you can't go 20 feet without stepping on. You're not wrong. Whoever is watching, make yourself known in the comment section down below. A rusty speaker lying on the track in turn 4. And a massive pothole on the backstretch are easier to avoid. We pass a couple of ramshackle buildings. The track's outer walls are covered in graffiti and grime. Very true there. There are signs of this once great oval's former life. The walls still bear weather-worn displays for Firestone and near the start-finish line. Nazareth Speedway is scrawled in faded red, white, and blue paint. We walk along the pit road and make our way to the checkered flag painted pavement of Victory Lane. That is the winner's circle. That was like the biggest thing I wanted to find. I knew about it and I'm like, I really want to like make an effort to find it. And when we did, I loved it. Like getting to stand in the winner's circle was amazing. It was something I never would have seen myself do. Standing in it, Andretti laments that he can't quite remember how many races he won there before Senajiking bodies bodies started keeping track for him. It no doubt upsets him that no other racing champion likely will ever stand where he's standing again. "It's a shame what happened here," Andretti half whispers early in our visit. "Credit to him, though. He's trying to be a good sport," he described. "What a tricky track it was," detailing the difficulties of an oval with significant elevation changes. "This was a quick mile and a half," Andretti says. "That kink before turn one, that took some guts to do that, to do flat out." So, the stuff that I'm reading about is crazy. I never thought that I'd fits with everything that we've seen recently. Later, he poses in Victory Lane for photos and unsolicited drops to his hands and knees to kiss the bricks at the start-finish line. As we walk along the back straightaway, near the end of our 90-minute tour, Andretti points out some particularly tall overgrowth and deadpan says those trees didn't used to be there. We would have had to dodge them. But when I ask about the Speedway's glory days, his mood shifts. It frustrates him to remember the days when this track thrived, when 30,000 fans packed the stands. Those were the days before the political inflating of the IRL/CART split in the mid-19th. Andretti says it brought us to our knees. It killed off many of what the track once was. His answers to my questions are abbreviated and detached. A few times, he changes the subject halfway through, once pivoting the conversation to his short-lived career as a commentator, then to the current state of IndyCar. Maybe it's a deliberate, maybe it's not. But he's reticent to allow himself to embrace this place when I suggest he has found memories. Andretti replies, the memories are vivid, and fond is one way to describe it. He gamingly poses for a few more photos and a short video interview before we hit the road. Following a few more stops around town and a tour of his home, we sit down inside his office and I finally tell him what I've been thinking for the past few hours. I feel like I took you there against your will. Andretti nods. Admitting the Speedway is a wound he isn't keen to revisit or reopen. It's not a happy reunion, he says. It's something that ended that was so meaningful, and it's still there staring at me, dilapidated, knowing what it meant to us as a family right from the very beginning. Me and Michael and Jeff and John Mario's sons and nephew drove there. It's got all of that history to it now. For round, I mean, it was so bad I didn't realize we were in the pit area. What he has done, he treats it like a race he's lost. It's over, nothing can be done except move on to the next race. It's all about winning, Andretti tells me at the end of our day together. It's all about wanting to win. It's seen or read before. Very convenient. I despise that it's easy, but the quintessential Mario Andretti. The truth is, you don't need to spend half a day with him in his hometown to understand who he is. He is the same man in hour number 5 as he is in minute number 5. Passionate, honest, competitive. He loves his family, God, and racing. In that order, probably. But it's damn close. The man loves to race. He lives to race. He recently turned 79 and he's still chasing speed. IndyCar, two-seaters, ultralight aircraft, surfboards with motors attached, you name it, he'll push it to its limits. But he's made numerous comebacks in the 25 years since. Even now, he's still at it. He's retired from competitive racing, and you'll be laughed at out of the room. It'd be an acceleration to say Andretti's two-seater is a mirror replica of a true blue Indy car. But it's not that big Grippier red tires on street and road course. So that he can squeeze every He even harbors dreams of getting his hands on one of the few machines he's never piloted. The one he plays a little closer to the vest. But when I push, there has to be something you want to drive. I say, he can't help but smile. I want to drive a current... Oh, that's so much to read. The first time he knew fulfilling the dream was possible, a Sunday, less than a year later, a 15-year-old kid was with stars in his eyes watching local legends rip up the dirt at Nazareth Speedway. In his soul, he's still that boy. He still has those stars in his eyes. If something were to happen, I asked to one of Michael's drivers, and he asked you to fill in at the 500, how would you do? His eyes twinkle and grin comes over his wrinkled but still handsome face. I know what he's about to say. I wouldn't finish last. I will tell you that much. He pauses for a second as if watching 500 miles unfold in his mind. Yeah, I wouldn't finish last. And that's the end of it. But it's crazy. Like, I wish that we could get in touch with either the Andretti's or get in touch of, like, defacing property and just breaking in. If that makes views that you have of a track that once was so popular. So talking about it, it kind of, it's crazy. So I'm going to look, as I was talking about last night, okay, so Justin had thought that Cars was filmed in PA. It was based off of a PA track. If you have a side gig and need to file, and if you think about it, taxusa.com. With us, your federal so is always free, and your state return is only $14.99. I'll show you guys what Thomasville Speedway looks like. Whoa. Okay. That is crazy. Of what Thomasville Speedway used to look like. So we do plan on traveling at some point. Summer's gonna be a little more easier for us to try and travel as much as we can. So, this is the picture I just found. It's kind of similar. It's kind of set up the same, if you think about it. Because, give me a second. So, this is Thomasville Speedway. So, over here is grandstands, as well as over here. So, these buildings over here, I would kind of say the buildings over here are kind of like what we see everywhere else. So this would be kind of like the Meteor Center. There's only one difference. This would be like the Meteor Center. This would be like the infield car center place. The garages, though... That's not a garage, never mind. Actually. This would be the Meteor Center, right here. On the inside of the track. It's so close as a resemblance to what. And then, like, this right here is kind of like what we walked through to get to the other side of the track. So part of the roads that we would come out on, we would come out on pit road. The road that they'd go on to get their car taken care of. And then, okay, so give me a second. I want to see if I can save that picture. Save image as. Yeah, that'll work. And then we'll go in here and we'll research again with Nazareth Speedway back then when it was done up. And actually not, like, torn apart and destroyed. This is what it used. Hold on. This is what it used to look like. So it's kind of set up the same. Set up a little differently, but not as bad. So that's what it looks like from back in the day. I'd assume out here is like where they all used to park, which is normal. So there used to be how every just about almost every track has one of those little bridges that they walk across. I believe that's the tunnel. So this is the tunnel. You have, okay, so here's gate one. Here's gate one, or gate three. Literally come up here, walking right here, so we're walking behind grandstands. Come around the corner, and right as you get to the end of the curve, you finally have the strip of the tunnel that brings you out. I will tell you right now, it felt so weird walking through that tunnel because it echoes, and like you're there at night and you're by yourself, so like you hear things behind you. Especially when everyone's like together in a group, you still hear things behind you, and it's so sketchy, it's so creepy. So then, right here, hold on, we have the media center. That building is sketchy, so freaking creepy. And then over here, we have the helipad and the infield care center. So if somebody got badly hurt, that's where they'd go to get seen before leaving the track. And then somewhere, no guarantee where, I'm struggling to find it now. Really struggling to find it. So this whole field right here is what we walked through, and it was weird. So this whole field is grown in. So imagine, since it's a tri-oval, imagine walking from one side to the other and you have to walk through grass at some point. So none of this right here, none of this right here is there anymore. That's gone. I believe these two pathways here are gone as well. So it's crazy. So these stands filled 45,000 people. It's crazy. But if you look at it closely, It's so close. And a resemblance to Thomasville. And knowing that it's that close in similarities to Thomasville. Dude, I went to a race car track that was kind of shown in my childhood movie. I grew up watching Cars and I loved it. It was my go-to favorite thing to watch. And to sit here and see it be such a resemblance. It's crazy. Save images. So, it's crazy to know that now it could either be Nazareth, or we could really take a step here, and we know what Thomasville looks like. Let's see what resemblance it could have with Willow. Willow Grove. Or Williams Grove is what I meant. There we go. Okay. I don't know. I'm gonna see if I can find a full picture of it. Maybe? It's possible. Because there's the bridge. It used to be a dirt track, so a dirt track resemblance is what's gonna be needed. Okay, so this is the whole track. Maybe not Williams Grove. There's so many tracks in PA. There's so many tracks in PA. I wouldn't know which one it would be. So there's also one in Sanatoga, Limerick, PA. Oh. Getting somewhere. Start your day with low prices and great deals from Target. Oh, let me look at it, of course. That was open in 1950s. Oh, that's possible. And it's just got a different outlook. But it does look like it holds about 45,000 people. This is crazy. I'm trying to sit here and find. Let's see if I can do it this way. I know this is going to be a very long video. Give me 1 second. Someone searched that before. So, I think this summer me and my friends are going to make a trip. Thomasville is primarily based on North Wilkesboro, North Carolina, located in a region known as the Moonshine Capital of America, and home to the North Wilkesboro Speedway, one of the first NASCAR tracks. So it is an actual track. Just in the movie, it was named differently. The fictional Thomasville Speedway, a dirt track in Cars 3, was inspired by a combination of both the, I cannot pronounce that word, Speedway and the North Wilkesboro dirt track. That makes sense. Thomasville could be named after Herb Thomas, a former race car driver who used to drive one of the real fabulous Hudson Hornets during the credits sequence. There is a sign advertising the Thomasville Speedway that indicates it is in Georgia. So Thomasville Raceway is in Georgia. Oh, we're gonna have a lot of fun this summer. So if you can't tell, I'm looking into going to more racetracks. This is something that hits close to home just because my family's big on it. And I would kind of love to learn more about it. Cars 3 will pay tribute to abandoned ghost tracks. That was written in 2017. The fictional Thomasville Speedway reflects many abandoned dirt ovals across the country. In the coming movie, Cars 3, our hero Lightning McQueen, seeking inspiration from NASCAR's dirt track past, visits the abandoned and fictional Thomasville Speedway. It's not just a plot tool wherein McQueen must look to racing's past in order to do well in its future. The scene is also a tribute to abandoned racetracks around the country. Research-wise, we went head deep into the history of NASCAR Cars 3. Director Brian Fee told us during a recent visit we had at Pixar. The history was great, you know, that's where the juice was. That's where the emotion was, looking at ghost tracks. Pixar workers shifted through hundreds of images of old races and old racetracks in the making of Cars 3. On our Pixar visit, creative director Jay Ward presented a slideshow of old photos tracing stock car racing in America back to the days of dirt roads and souped-up Fords. When the team was researching Cars 3, they included on-site visits to abandoned racetracks from NASCAR's past, including North Wilkesboro and another speedway, both of which were part of the championship when the series started in 1949. Both are located in North Carolina. North Wilkesboro stayed open until 1996. So they stayed open until a year before I was born. Then reopened briefly in 2010 and 2011. The other speedway closed in 1968. Both hosted NASCAR's top echelons in their glory days. This is crazy. Like I did last night, I will do more research on this, or more into this. maybe later on tonight when I get home. But to anybody on my channel that is watching, thank you for following and subscribing. Please give me some more subscribes. Please tell your friends and family. I only have 7 subscribers. I'm trying to get more likes and follows on there just because I want to make this a full-time job at some point. Once I have this going for years, I want to be able to make the big money off of it and make this my full-time job. And I think it'd be really, really cool to make this my full-time job, especially if my friends are all down for that, rather than the boring old boring old jobs that they have now. They're not as fun. So to be able to do something like this as a full-time job would be awesome. Please come back. Keep watching our videos. Mine are going to be miscellaneous videos here and there. They are going to be a little out of order. They are going to be a little disorganized, per se. And just me rambling on. Once I get talking about something and I kind of like get into it good, I can't stop. But this is about a 41-minute video and I'm starting to feel bad. Please hit that subscribe button down below. Hit that like button. Get my name out there. I appreciate my fans that have followed me, even though some of them are my family from the group. And some of them are my family. Please, please, go hit that subscribe button below. I'm begging you. Tell your friends, tell your family. And I'll catch you guys back later. Peace.